you for all that you do, leading us every Sunday in praise and worship. So thanks so much. As you guys exit off, and we got our esteemed panel coming up here to the stage to have a little discussion here this morning, discussion in the sermon series that we've been talking about for 2 weeks now. This is the second week in that series called Preppers. And again, I would encourage you to go grab your Bible, open up your Bible to Matthew chapter 24, grab a pen, get ready to do a little writing, jotting things down. In fact, throughout this week, I want to encourage you to stay in God's Word just as you are here this morning with us. And maybe take that pen or highlighter, and as you read through the scripture, just whatever God brings to your mind, whatever He wants to show you, just kind of highlight that and study it, look at that. And together we'll be spending time in God's Word Bible study throughout the week. But guys, thanks so much for being with us again this Sunday morning. We're looking at preppers, and today we've called it Prepped for Finals. I'd like to begin this morning by giving you some good news and some bad news. First, the good news. We like good news first, right? All right, first the good news. The good news, Jesus Christ is coming back soon. That's the good news. Here's the bad news. Jesus Christ is coming back soon. You see, whether it's good news or bad news simply depends on you and where you're at, if you're ready or not. That's for each one of us. Is it good news for you or is it bad news for you? I don't know about you guys, but I was never very well prepped for the finals. This is about the time of the year when they'd be doing finals right now, right? Or getting close. And I was one of those, I could procrastinate with the best of them, and I'd put it off. Any of you straight-A students? None of us? None of us?
There are no pastors that are straight-A students, I don't think.
We're all the slackers up here, right? Yeah, okay. Well, you guys can relate. But it was for the finals, it was usually homeroom, man. I'd start pulling out the books and studying, cramming for the finals. And that caused a lot of anxiety. That caused a lot of worry there in that moment of what would happen when I had to take these finals. In a weird sort of way, we're there again. Jesus Christ, He said, I'm coming back, and I'm coming back soon. And He says it over and over. And so knowing that, believing that, we have to evaluate where we are as to whether it's good news or bad news. Hey, wherever you're at here this morning, we want to look at God's Word. We want to study it. We want to today prepare ourselves. We find that in Matthew chapter 24. And kind of what's going on right here is the disciples pull Jesus aside. They get Him alone, and they say, hey, shoot straight with us, okay? When will all this stuff happen? When will all this stuff go down? And here's what Jesus says, okay? Later, Jesus sat on the Mount of Olives. His disciples came to Him privately and said, tell us, when will all this happen? What sign will signal your return and the end of the world? Jesus told them, don't let anyone mislead you, for many will come in My name, claiming, I am the Messiah. They will deceive many, and you will hear of wars and threats of wars, or maybe your translation reads rumors of wars. He says, but don't panic. Yes, these things must take place, but the end won't follow immediately. Nation will go to war against nation and kingdom against kingdom. There will be famines. King James Version puts in the next word, pestilences, and earthquakes in many parts of the world. But all this is only the first of the birth pains. Now, if you would, just right there in your Bible, I want you to circle the words birth pains. We're going to come back to that here in just a moment. He says, but all of this is only the first of the birth pains with more to come. Then you will be arrested and persecuted and killed. You will be hated all over the world because you are My followers. And many will turn away from Me and betray and hate each other. Many false prophets will appear and will deceive many people. Sin will be rampant everywhere, and the love of many will grow cold, but the one who endures to the end will be saved. And the good news about the kingdom will be preached throughout the whole world so that all nations will hear it. And then, He says, then the end will come. Lot to digest right there. Heavy, heavy words that we find Jesus speaking to us. And if you'll notice, throughout this, there are a lot of different what I call signs that he's giving us. He's saying it's not happening yet, but these are signs that will let you know we're getting closer and closer. These are signs to be on the watch for, to look out for. But you guys also noticed that he said the words birth pains, right? Two of us on stage here have experienced childbirth. The rest of us kind of act like we know what it's like, but we don't. I do remember my job in when
it was not your job. Well, it was not your job. You took it as your job.
I thought they gave me that job.
To watch the monitor?
Yeah.
No, here it comes. And I'm like, stop.
I was helping you out. I was warning you. Okay. I was letting you know what's that. Now, what is it?
I had no idea. Thank you.
They have the little monitor and it's attached to the belly and it actually gauges the frequency and intensity of the pain, right? And so when it started to get like shooting up there, I'm like, it's about to happen. We're getting closer. And that's how we kind of know, right? Do me a quick favor. Write down the words frequency and intensity somewhere on your outline or in your notes, or if you're taking notes on a piece of paper, because that's what these signs are referring. He says birth pains, and we know that when frequency increases and intensity increases, well, that's when we know it's getting even closer. Okay, so here we've been given that, and we've been able to see that these times or the signs of these end times. As we go through this, you'll see more and more of this happening, and they'll get to be more and more intense. And so that's kind of the picture that Jesus is giving us here. But I tell you what, let's go ahead and take a moment. I want to pray, and then we're going to jump in and outline seven signs of the end times, and then we're going to move on to the whole purpose behind this prophecy altogether. Father, thank you so much that you care enough about us, your children, to speak to us, to let us know, to give us your word, to give us things to look to. Father, I pray that through this, that we won't be distressed. We won't come out of this worried. Instead, Father, just the opposite, that we'll come out of this moment today rejoicing, excited, thrilled at what is to come, and at the same time with this intensity about ourselves, that we will find why it is we're here in this world and the purpose that we've been put here, so that we can move in these final days, reaching as many people as we can for you. Father, thank you so very much for your love for us. Give us peace now. Give us insight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Guys, seven signs of the end times. The first one that I want us to write down here this morning is what we call the coming of the Antichrist and spiritual deception. Jesus said this, don't let anyone mislead you. He was telling his disciples that that's a possibility, that there will be those who come along and they'll claim to be, they'll say, I'm Jesus, or I'm Jesus, or I'm Jesus, and there will be many that are led away as the result. And so that's one of the first signs that we need to be looking out for, is the coming of the Antichrist and spiritual deception in these end times. Pastor Glenn, I think you did a little research on this, and in talking about those people as of recently in our world who are claiming to be Jesus. Have you looked at a little bit of that?
Yeah, I just did a little online search, people claiming to be Jesus, and many articles came up, which sort of surprised me. There's probably a lot of people in the 7+ billion people in the world who maybe think they're Jesus, but these are people who have actual disciples and have an actual following. There was one article about 7 people who claim to be Jesus. And just in reading the article, I recognized 2 things right away. One, their lifestyle was nothing like the Jesus that we read in the Bible. And you could sort of see already that these guys had a personal agenda that was about them. These are 7 people from all over the world, by the way, all different parts of the world. But the most glaring thing that I noticed is that none of the 7 went on the cross on Good Friday, died, and then rose again on Easter Sunday. So I'm thinking none of them are actual the Jesus. So.
Yeah. It's shocking sometimes, though, because you see these different people that some of you probably remember, Jim Jones and so forth, mm-hmm. and the following that he had. In fact, one of the members of our church went in and actually his job was to help clean up after the mass suicide there. And it's just shocking when you see stuff like that and you're going, how in the world can people fall for stuff like that? How can they be so easily deceived? And I think you just kind of gave us a hint as to how not to, because Jesus said, you'll know them by their fruits and what's produced in their life. And so that's a good thing for us to be warned about during those times. But yeah, it's really amazing when you see that. The coming of the Antichrist and spiritual deception. We're going to move through these rather quick, guys. The second one I want you to write down is wars and rumors of wars. Jesus, again, he said, you will hear of wars and threats of wars or rumors of wars. He says, but don't panic. Yes, these things must take place, but the end won't follow immediately. This is leading up to it. And when we say wars and rumors of wars, of course, rumors of wars are the kind of the rattling of the swords. It's the threats. It's you guys do this, and then we'll retaliate and do this. Or there's standoffs all around. But it's really interesting when you do research, and like you did right there, and like so many of us up here. I'm going to encourage you to go online and look up some of this stuff and Google it. It's now more easily accessible than ever before. But Pastor Neil, I think you were looking at some of these conflicts. Weren't you as well?
Yeah, the website was saying that there are only, of all the nations that we have in the world, there are only 11 nations in the world that don't have some sort of conflict going on within their nations.
It's shocking. And it's not just major wars, but it's conflict within a country, those type of wars. And Kim, when we were just in Uganda at that the church there near the orphanage, one of the things that shocked me the first time when we were there that first time was the amount of children versus adults in that church. And so we asked around, and I can't, maybe Erica, you can remember the statistic there. Wasn't it just over 70%?
It's like 75%.
Was it 75? Yeah, somewhere in that neighborhood of the population of Uganda is under the age of 16. And the reason is because of the conflict that they've had, and the genocide that has taken place, the Lord's Resistance Army, when they moved in and so many people were slaughtered, that now basically you have babies raising babies by and large in that country. But that's not just there. That's in other places as well around the world. So we see those wars and rumors of wars. And remember, increase in intensity and frequency, those two words, frequency and intensity, the birth pains for this to come. The third thing we want to look at is number three, famine. Famine. Jesus said there will be famines. Anybody have any? Kim, you did a little research.
I read there were 193 million people at the end of 2019 who were famished, and because of the coronavirus, it probably will double.
Oh, but
double, yeah.
That's so shocking. It's so sad to hear. And we've gone to the grocery store. I don't know how many of you have gone to the grocery store lately. And for us, we go and oh, they don't have my can of soup that I wanted, right? But for others, the coronavirus is much worse for them because they go and there is no food as a result. They're talking right now of shortages that we might face. But by and large, it's not even to the extent or to that measure. Before that, before the coronavirus, I think it was the WHO, World Health Organization, estimated one-third of people in the world were famished or starving. One-third of people were malnourished, and one-third of people ate healthy in the world. And then one more that we were talking about earlier I wanted to point out was how many children per minute die? 23 children per minute die of starvation in the world that we live in right now, which I did a little bit of math. That would mean by the end of this service, 1,380 children will die just because of starvation, because of being famished and illnesses that come along with being malnourished. So shocking there. Let's move on. We've got four more. Number four, sickness and disease. Do we really have to even talk about this one? That's a lot, right? I mean, that's going on. Have any of you looked up any of this type of stuff? But I mean, we got the COVID-19. But before that, name some of them that we've been facing.
Swine flu.
Swine flu was one.
SARS.
Ebola. We can go on and on and on with the different sicknesses and diseases coming up.
Resurgence of all of the
measles.
Yeah.
And here in Scripture, it's called pestilences, or that type of disease that we find. Sickness and disease, number five, earthquakes and natural disasters. It's interesting because Jesus comes right out and says it. There will be earthquakes in many parts of the world, or this trembling of the earth and the disasters that can come along with that. I think this is another area. Erica, I think you might even have the app right now that takes you to earthquakes that occur in the frequency and intensity.
Right. I think definitely earthquakes and natural disasters are something. If you just look back over the last year and think about things that we've seen throughout the world, that app says that over 200 or hundreds of earthquakes happen daily all over the world. But just also think about natural disasters. Africa's facing a locust swarm again.
Oh, yeah.
Floods, wildfires, California, Australia, you know, the Amazon. So definitely increase in frequency and intensity.
Yeah, I mean, how many times, not just in this year, but back in 2019, where we're going, there's this fire here, and there's this tragedy, this disaster here, and all of that, you're going, wow, so much is going on. And I thought one thing that was really kind of interesting as well is that because of the coronavirus, scientists are saying our lack of movement, airplanes and so forth, has caused our world to quit vibrating like it had been doing. And evidently that vibration would create an ambient sound that I guess most of us don't even notice or pick up. But because of the lack of vibration, because we've all slowed down, the scientists, seismologists, are able to detect even more earthquakes because our world's gotten quieter by and large. And so when an earthquake can happen, they're detecting even more while this is happening here. So I thought that was really interesting. We've got to move on. Number six will then be persecution of the church and human depravity. The way Jesus said it here, he goes, sin will be rampant everywhere, that you will be persecuted. There's a good website for this. Who grabbed that?
Yeah, it was me.
Did you, D?
Yeah, there were some astonishing things when I was looking at it. You know, the one I was looking at has 245 million Christians in the world experience persecution. And there's a couple of other ones. But a big one, 11 Christians killed every day for their faith.
Goodness, wow. And that definitely has been increasing. There are countries, and certain countries in particular right now, I think it points out, the persecution that has taken place in China, the persecution that has taken place, of course, in North Korea, and then a lot of in different parts of the Mideast, extreme persecution that is going on. So that definitely is on a rise. In fact, if you want to do a little more research on that, it's opendoorsusa.org, who carries a lot of that information. They track it on a regular basis, opendoorsusa.org. And then finally, we have number seven, false prophets and the worldwide proclamation of the gospel. Again, Jesus says, hey, watch out, because people are going to come. They're going to try to deceive you. They're going to be those wolves in sheep's clothing. But then one of the exciting things is he says the whole world will have heard the gospel. Worldwide proclamation. Years ago, we were thinking, that's not going to happen in our lifetime. I mean, that's crazy that because of all the different languages and how difficult it is. But Jody, I think you were looking at some of that, what's taking place, and it's really shocking.
That's true. One of our missionaries, Kurt and Cindy Flanagan, I don't know if they're watching today, but he has all the stats on this, and we stay in touch with him. There's only, believe it or not, a couple thousand people groups that do not have scripture at the moment. And by the year 2033, they think that every group will have scripture. And that's an encouraging sign that the gospel is going to get taken all over the world. And so Kurt and Cindy, you know, they're doing a great work with the seed company. But if you want to know more information about that, just check out theseedcompany.org.
Yeah, that right there really just blows my mind, because for so long, you would think, well, it's got to be so many years away. But to actually say 2033, every nation or every language will have its own Bible, and people can read the gospel in their own language, that just, it's amazing. But then, that's where Jesus says, and then, when that happens, then the end will come. Here I come, I'm coming back. So I wanted us to go through these seven signs of the end times just as something where we're able to see it, we're able to know it, we're able to be aware. And even as we're doing this, it's kind of a list where you're going, ugh, right? I mean, it's just, it's sad and it's heavy. And maybe you're feeling sad and heavy and you're going, Pastor Bo, why would you even do a sermon series on this? Why would you talk about this in church on Sunday, especially right now? And the reason is because it is in God's word. It's here, and we have to be faithful to God's word. And as your pastor, or you guys as pastors, you know the weight and the heaviness that we feel to make sure that everybody is prepared, everybody is ready. And so it's like the teacher in school that says, you got a final coming up, but I'm not going to help you get ready for it. And what a foolish teacher that would be. No, we need to be ready, we need to be prepared, and we need to see how that this really is good news for those who are believers. Here's what I want to do. I want us to go through what we call the purpose of this prophecy. Why did Jesus say this? Why did he teach this? Why is it shared? Why is it here in God's word? And I'm going to give you three things. Number one, first of all, the purpose of this prophecy, number one, is as a warning. It serves as a warning for the world. A warning for the world. Revelation 1:7, look, he comes with the clouds of heaven, and everyone will see him, even those who pierced him. And all the nations of the world will mourn for him. And you might even say, because of him, here he is, will mourn for him. Yes, amen. Now, this is where we shift and we go to the book of Revelation. And right here at the beginning of the book of Revelation, he says, he's coming. He's coming. He's coming soon. And when he comes, the world, by and large, are going to be shocked, and they're going to be terrified, and there's going to be a great mourning, almost a sense of, they've been telling us about this for so long, and we didn't believe it, but it's happening now. It serves as a warning for the world. Let me ask real quick. You guys, when you're out there on the highway, and you're driving, and come in the opposite direction, you see somebody flash their lights. Anybody know what that means?
Police up ahead.
Policeman ahead.
That's right. That's right. I don't know from experience, but no, just, you know, that's not true. I do know from experience, but the flashing of the lights, what happens? Uh-oh, in your mind you're going, there's somebody right there, just around the corner. There's a policeman, he's waiting, he's ready. And so what do? Well, you take your foot off the gas, you slow it down a little bit, right? You get back under that speed limit, you kind of get back in line. And that's the warning. But what a fool would a person be who floors it when they see the lights come. No, it serves as a warning in the same way. All these things that Jesus said, he's saying, hey, watch out to the world. It serves as a warning for us. And so I wanted us to talk about that here for just a moment, because could it be that Jesus is saying, hey, watch out, be prepared, be ready, and to the point that the world, we turn and we repent and we stop and we change. Any thoughts on that?
One of the things I'm thinking about right now, we got one grandkid. Well, we got two, but one loves to play hide and seek. And we'll start counting to 10, and Sammy will count also. As ready or not, here I come. And that's what Jesus is saying right now. Ready or not, here I come. I want to warn you that this, you need to occupy till I come. You need to be doing these things. And I believe right now as the church, we've got to be evangelizing. We've got to be witnessing to people because, again, I don't want Pete to be the only one in heaven. I want Bo and Kim and Neil, and Neil. I want everybody that I encounter to get to go to heaven. And when we see this frequency and intensity coming up, then we've got to start telling the gospel more. And you said something earlier about, I think it was James Cain that had gone into the Jonestown, Guyana thing. And this is a big thing. We've got to go to our Bible. We've got to go to our scriptures. When leaders come and try to separate us from our Bible, we need to beware right there, you know, flag on the play. Because they said about 900 bodies in there, and they only saw about one Bible. So when we leave the comfort and the scripture and the foundation of the Bible, we can easily just be hoodwinked. And we don't want that to happen at all. Definitely.
Great point right there.
I was reading a quote this week that I really liked, because sometimes revelation can be a lot, error can be scary, but it was meant to give hope that Jesus is coming back. But the quote was, prophecy is not meant to scare us, but prepare us.
Great point.
I like that point too. I was thinking the same sort of thing. The first half of our discussion is kind of intense and scary, the signs and the warnings, but here we're turning the corner to really celebration and excitement and a spectacular event that's going to happen when Jesus comes back. And it kind of reminded me of back in college, I took a lot of creative writing classes, and one of our professors would say, start your story with the end in mind. And you think, well, would that be boring or predictable? But really, when you do start to write a story with the end in mind, then you realize, oh, it's actually, you can be exciting here. I know what's going to happen. I know where we're going. I know where I'm going. So we can enjoy this ride, and it becomes an adventure. And so, you know, John, in his revelation here, gives us a taste of an encouragement, really, for believers. Hey, look, we know that there's actually victory here, and that Jesus is visible and will be visible when he comes back. And that's energizing and exciting for believers.
I'm with you there. I get real excited right now about what's going on with this virus, because I believe this very well could be what God uses to bring worldwide revival, people back to himself. And I can't help but think of the story of Jonah. And he didn't want to go to Nineveh. He didn't want to share that prophecy that God was going to destroy them. In fact, he went the other way and ended up in the belly of a well. But then when he finally went, he went with, and you can read the attitude, it's almost like God's about to get rid of all of you. And walk through the town saying that, thinking that nobody would listen to him and nobody would hear his message and nobody would turn to God. But just the opposite happened. And the king himself, who was a wicked king, declared, no, well, we better get on our knees before God, or we better humble ourselves before him in sackcloth and ashes. And there was a whole turning of that entire city. And what if what we see going on now is simply God moving us, God turning us, God changing us, God bringing people back to himself? How exciting that is. Nations turning back to him.
Yeah, the big thing too is I've read, there's an atheist that's done a talk about Christians and reaching out to other Christians, and it's always stuck with me because he talks about the idea that you're sitting on the sidewalk or you're sitting outside and you see a guy in the road and you see a bus coming at him, and how excited would you be? And aren't you? It's the time's getting close. And that we need to save as many people because of Christ. We need to reach out, and this time is essential for that. Being a cheerleader and talking about the coronavirus and how things are, being a former cheerleader, I think about this time being like a pep rally. If you think about the big game that's coming up, and this is the time we can all get together and say, hey, come on, guys, let's do it. Let's get ready for this game. This game is coming. It's almost to an end. And just getting people pumped up about Jesus and who Jesus is in our lives.
Made me think of the...
There you go.
Yeah, man. It's coming. The victory's there, right? Very good. Number two, the purpose of this prophecy, a blessing for the believer. It serves as a blessing for the believer. It's kind of interesting because when you first read this, you're going, where is blessing in this stuff? You get to the book of Revelation, and it's introduced by this right here. God blesses the one who reads the words of this prophecy to the church, and he blesses all who listen to its message and obey what it says, for the time is near. How in the world can Revelation, can what Jesus says right here, how can that be a blessing to us right now? Any thoughts?
For me, when I was younger, I would read, I don't want to read Revelation because it's scary. I don't want to think about dying. But now, as I'm older and more mature, old, but I see it as a blessing, because I see it as truth. You see it happening. You see it happening, and so you can believe the word. And I don't know if that makes sense, but like the word becomes more real in my mind because I see all these things happening. And we don't have to be afraid. I mean, we don't know when the end is. We don't know when our end is. But just like you said, like we got to get riled up. We got to get going. We got to, help other people find him.
Yeah.
But I mean, I don't know if that makes sense, but it is a blessing because I see the truth in his word through it.
I think you're absolutely right. And I think it is that maturity. As a Christian, or in the United States, and we've seen this in the United States, by and large, we live a very blessed life, charmed life, I would almost say, compared to so many other places around the world. But you can go to some place where there is suffering around the world, and their calls for, please, Jesus, come back, are so much more than ours would be. I think maybe we get a little comfortable here. We think, this is all right. This is not too bad. I'm kind of liking this. I'm enjoying this. And sometimes all the blessings that we have here now keep us from being able to look to the blessings that he has waiting for us in the future. And I liken it to this. I've done this before. You remember when our kids were real little, and I can't remember what mall it was, but we took them to the Disney store. And they were like, oh, the Disney store, greatest store. It's awesome, awesome. And then later on we said, hey, guys, we're taking you to Disney World. And they thought, oh, Disney store. And they couldn't even conceive of what was about to happen. They were still thinking, this is fun. I like Disney store. But what we were about to take them to was so much bigger and so much more. And I think if we can, hearing God's word, and we see it and we soak it in and we read it, we begin to realize that it's bigger than we can dream of or imagine when Jesus does come back, how he makes everything right. And there's the blessing and the thrill in here and now because of what is to come. And I think that maturity is definitely a thing that it has to take.
Joseph Stoll tells a story similar to that. He says that he was, he's a pastor. He was kind of going through a special needs home one day, and he noticed that there was a glass wall, and on that glass wall there are fingerprints all over the wall. And he asked one of the people in that school, again, it's a special needs school, and said, what happened in this glass wall? There's fingerprints everywhere. He said, well, last week we taught the kids about the second coming of Christ and that he was coming back. And he said, in their free time, every day they go to that glass and put their hands on that glass waiting for Christ to come. And he said, they've been so excited the last week that that's all they want to do in their free time. And if we lived like that, it would really change each day and every moment of every day.
The faith of a child. That is so, so good. We were talking earlier about the sickness and the disease and the famine and other places around the world that are struggling, and something recently that happened with Whispers of Love, where we were, Kim and I were over there a couple months ago, and there's this one little boy, his name's Oscar, and Oscar was HIV positive. He had a heart condition as well, and he'd sit there and eat his beans and rice. And the thing about Oscar, anytime one of the other kids would come up to him, he'd take a little grain of rice and pass out his food.
He didn't want them close to him, so he would give them food to make them go
away.
He was a little old man.
He really was.
We call him that, Erica, a little old man.
But the heartbreaking thing is Oscar died recently. But as sad as that is, at the same time you're going, but now Oscar has so much more. Is so much more, and that's the comfort, and that's the blessing, and that's the hope, that as painful as it might be here, or wherever the struggles that we face, the blessing is, look what's about to happen. Look what's coming when Jesus does return. It is a blessing for us. It's a blessing for the believer. And then finally, number three, it's a motivation for my mission. A motivation for my mission. Dee, I think you're talking a little bit about this, weren't you? I mean, just getting us psyched up, getting us ready. Here's why we're here. Here's what we got to be about.
I mean, to be ready, I mean, it's kind of like when you're going on a trip. If I was walking down a path and I stopped by the lake or stopped by a little creek and I enjoy the scenes, but there's a peak. There's a point that we're going to get to on the journey. And that's what I want to encourage people to do. Bring people on the journey because there's a peak. There's something that we're going to see. We're going to be able to spend time with God in heaven, and we're going to be in heaven with him. And just, it's so essential. And I talk about it all the time. What we do and how we talk to somebody for a second can change their lives for an eternity. Yeah. And how important that is that we do every single day.
Yeah.
There's freedom in knowing that God has a plan, that there is victory at the end. Kind of reminds me of when you play golf. If you're in a tournament, you usually play best ball. And when I'm on part of the foursome, I'm always happy that there's someone else who can actually hit the golf ball. But usually when Jody and Neil and I will play with Butch, Pastor Butch, in these tournaments, and I'll hit one in the woods, and you know, but Butch will hit one where it's supposed to go. And then you know the pressure's off. Okay, Neil, we got one.
Listen to that. No respect. No, yeah. No respect.
Every once in a while, Jody or Neil might hit one where it's supposed to go.
Come on. I'm out.
But Butch is, come on, won't you agree? Butch is pretty reliable. So he'll hit one, and then the pressure's off, and we can play the game. We're like, okay, we know we got one where it's supposed to go, so let's get busy and let's do what we got to do. Anyway, I think that analogy works. But,
no, it didn't work. No.
I really don't know what you're saying there. Yeah.
I think, though, we sometimes get so afraid to share because we don't want to be preachy or we don't know the Bible, you know, or whatever, but they'll know him by our love. And, you know, you don't have to quote scripture all the time. We should know it. But what I'm saying is we need to look different, you know, just be kind, show love, you know.
I really think that's what it means right here, what you're saying. Revelation chapter 1, verses 5 through 6. All glory to him who loves us and has freed us from our sins by shedding his blood for us. He has made us a kingdom of priests. What are priests supposed to do? They're that intermediary between a person and God. And he's made us a kingdom of priests, a kingdom of all people going out to share that love with the world, those around us. Kingdom of priests for God his Father. All glory and power to him forever and ever. Amen. What a calling. What a high calling. What a purpose for us in life. Do you ever feel like maybe we just need to be shaken? Wake up. Wake up. You've got a big job to do. Don't miss your big job. This virus, I think, has caused a lot of us to evaluate, again, what's really important in life. A lot of the stuff that we would go through the motions of doing, we're not doing anymore. We're put on hold. It's almost like he says, go to your room and think about what you've done. go think about it for a little bit, because we need to get you back on purpose. Back on purpose. It is a motivation for my mission. And that's why we're called to be here, guys. Can you get excited?
Amen.
Yes.
Can you get excited? I think we need to get excited. We need to be excited about a revival that has to happen, a revival that has to come, where people come back to Jesus like we've never seen before. People respond to the good news, the gospel. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to end the service today in a little different way. I'm going to ask Brad to come back here on the stage. And there's a song. We've been doing several oldies here. And this is yet another kind of oldie, but it has a powerful message. And as he begins to sing this song, I want you, wherever you're at, to be thinking first about yourself and are you ready? Are you prepared? And then I also want you to think about those in your household, your husband, your wife, your kids, parents. Are they ready? Do you know they're ready? And then think about the friends, those around you, those in your neighborhood, those people that you might work with normally. Are they ready? Because it's a very sobering song and it's a sobering time for us to be sure that we know for sure where we're going to go when we die or when Jesus returns. Listen.
All of us got trampled on the floor. I wish we'd all been ready. The children died, the days grew cold. A piece of bread could buy a bag of gold. I wish we'd all been ready. There's no time to change your mind. The sun has come.
Jesus for saving me. I know one day I'll be rejoiced. friend, for all of us rejoicing in heaven, wouldn't it be great if we could all rejoice with those here who we love, that family member, that friend? Is there anybody that you know needs to hear the good news? Be bold. Be bold. Have that conversation, talk. Share the gospel. Be that priest that brings them to the love of the Father. Father, I thank you so much for your great love for us, and that you stepped down out of heaven to save us. We praise you. We celebrate you, Jesus. And we look for your return one day soon. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Awesome discussion today. By the way, there may be some people who received Christ as their Savior today. We'd love to hear about it. You can actually text the words new life to 678-498-7688 if you receive Christ today. And that'd be a great way for us to be able to interact with you about that decision.
Hey, what was that number again? Oh, here we go.
I think we have it. Yep, 678-498-7688.
Text new life. Very good.
So we're going to take the offering in just a minute. Several ways to give. You can text our giving number. Also, you can give online or the drop box here at the church near the main entrance, near the front door there. Of course, you can use snail mail, the old USPS.
Still works.
And it's been awesome just to see people still engaged and just being the church, serving, giving. It's been wonderful. Next week, Virtual Community Week. You've heard of like Spirit Week at schools and things where people kind of come together by doing, you know, crazy things. Well, we're going to do that as well. And we want the crazy things we want to do together will be things like honoring and celebrating our friends and neighbors, graduates, teachers, local businesses, and things like that. So start thinking about how you can encourage, support, and show your love to our community. And look for social media, and on our website, we're going to post reminders about ideas, how you can do things like that. Prayer and praise and prayer drive-in service coming up May 6th.
I really want this service to be a time where we gather in our cars around this place and take some time to really pray, Pray for what we talked about today. Pray for revival here in our community, but also in our state, in our nation, and around the world. And we can come together and we can do like we did the last time, stay in our cars. There'll be a lot of great music and so forth, and we'll celebrate. But at the same time, I think I want to call us out to be people of prayer and do this here now together, okay? It's going to be a great service. And can I speak just real quick? Next Sunday, again, we're online. And we're just taking every precaution possible. We are hoping, I don't know, we'll see, not sure. We're going to keep monitoring and watching, hoping that on Mother's Day we could have some people here in the three different services that we're planning. That's subject to change, obviously. And if we're not feeling like it's going to be a safe thing to do, then we'll certainly hold off a little bit longer and maybe be looking for our next opening service, whatever date that would be, to be a really kind of a big Easter service all over again. Yes. Wouldn't that be a fun, fun celebration? So stay tuned with us. Keep watching, waiting, listening, and we'll get that information out. But Pastor Glenn, like you said again, I'm amazed at how the church is continuing to be the church. Mm. During a time like this, and we see it evidenced in all sorts of ministry that still happens, still takes place, and people serving other people, and people continuing to give. Over and over, we have people driving up here and dropping things off, and it's just been it's overwhelming, I guess, when you see it. It's such a blessing to see how God's people work and move, and so thank you guys so much for doing that. You guys ready to take the offering?
Yes.
Let's do it. Father, we give to you right now. With joy in our hearts, with a whole new perspective, perhaps, on what really matters, what really is important. Father, help us to continue to be the church you want us to be during this day, during this time. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray.